chicken. Everything is cool, dude. I'm sitting over there watching the video, and I was like, you know, you don't know how blessed you are.
It's true.
I mean, because, and I wasn't emotional until I saw Karen. But you know what? You really don't know how blessed you are, because some of us have lost our mothers.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's still times that I think, as I'm coming back from work, thinking, I need to give her a call. I need to see her. And then it strikes me. But you know what? I know where she's at.
Amen.
I wouldn't dare ask for her to come back to this place.
Yeah.
Because she is with the King, our Savior. Thanks a lot, Karen. We'll go ahead and do our tithes and our offerings.
Morning.
For those of you that may not know, my name's Mary Maid, and on behalf of our Women's Fellowship here at the church, we would like to wish all of our mothers Happy Mother's Day today. Guys, let's honor our mothers. Thank you so much for being here today. We do honor our mothers, and we have a couple of potted plants up here on the communion table for a couple of our mothers. Now today we're just going to go with the oldest mother and the youngest. Okay, we have a mother that is over 80. Okay, we have a mother that's... Okay, June. Well, congratulations. After service, you can come and get one of the five plants, okay? All right, our youngest mother. Do we have a mother that is younger than 25?
Yeah, one back here.
How about a mother younger than 30? Okay, how about 35? We've got a mother younger than 35. Okay, we have a winner back here. Congratulations to her. Thanks for joining us today. And again, Happy Mother's Day. Now, I'm filling in again today for another position here, and I have a scripture for us for our worship service today, okay? Psalms 104, verses 33 and 34 says, I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. Yeah. Say that with me.
I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live.
And then it goes on to say, I will sing praise to my God while I have my being.
Yes.
My meditation of him shall be sweet. I will be glad in the Lord.
Amen.
So when we worship today, sing unto the Lord and praise the Lord as we sing. Now today we want to let you know that we're proud to have Brother Ron Hughes on the stage with us today.
Amen.
And he's going to help us to sing. We're going to sing, This is the Day the Lord Hath Made. And then we're going to sing, His Name is Wonderful. And then in honor of our mothers that are in heaven, we're going to sing, How Beautiful Heaven Must Be.
Amen.
And you all know all of these songs, so we want you to just belt it out with us today when we sing praises unto God and to in honor of our mothers. Thank
Amen.
You.
Amen.
Now I think I can do a tithe. Let's go to God. Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful morning that you blessed us with. Lord, you've heard the prayer request. You see what's on our heart. Lord, as we just turn to you in this service, Holy Spirit, have your way. Lord, we take these tithes and these offerings. We ask that you multiply them. We give them back to your kingdom so that more of your creation can know that blessed spirit of adoption in their life. So as we turn back to you, Lord, take it, multiply it as only you can, and we'll give you the glory, the honor, and praise for it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, John.
He is the mighty. down in the yard, picking dandelions all day. I rushed to the front door when I gathered enough to give to my mom, show her my love. When I held out my hand, she looked down at
get through all this. I told someone the only difference I noticed in having that pneumonia was the fact that as long as I wasn't talking, I was all right. So you all know where that puts me. When you got the gift of gab, you can't just not talk. It just doesn't happen that way. But anyway, I'm glad that the Lord was able to get me through all that. I've got, listen, y'all be here all evening. I've got 3 weeks of sermon. Lined up. But I appreciate you. We really do. Well, I certainly appreciate Brother John. I really appreciate him. I was telling some folks earlier this morning in the vestibule as we were coming in. It's good. I'm going to try not to cry, John. I'll try not to. It's good to have somebody that you can count on and that you can trust. But because, you know, when a pastor has a flock and under your care, you have to be careful. You really got to be careful who you turn your flock over to if you're not able to do that. And I thank God for this guy.
Amen.
I do. I can trust him. I know that all I have to do is just send that text or give him that call. And he's right there. He's ready and willing and steps up and does whatever I need. And that takes a big load off of you. That takes a big load off of you to know you've got somebody to do that. So I certainly appreciate it. Well, I'm not a theme preacher. I mean, sometimes, you know, holidays or you know, we try to get a theme, but I'm not that way. I just kind of go about what I feel like the Lord is leading me to go in the direction. Today we're going to talk about Jesus being the author and the finisher of our faith. You Bible readers have heard that. You can quote it. You probably know it upside down and backwards. But we're going to take a little time to talk about just exactly what that means today. If you're able, I want to ask you to stand and turn to Hebrews chapter 12. We're going to look at these first two verses. Hebrews chapter 12. And I know this is familiar scripture to you. If you're a Bible marker, some people mark their Bibles. You will see, because I mark mine too. I preach these verses back in January. But trust me, this is not the same sermon. I don't keep my sermons. I really don't. I don't save them so that I can go back and pull them up down the road and maybe preach the same thing. There's nothing wrong with doing that. I'm kind of like the one pastor that said, if a sermon ain't worth preaching twice, it wasn't worth preaching once. And I pretty much agree with that too. But that's not what we're here to talk about. That I talked about in January. Today we're going to talk about Christ being the author and the finisher of our faith. So as we look at the scripture here, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, the writer says, therefore, and that therefore means everything that he has already told us in chapter 11. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. Say that with me. Looking unto Jesus. He is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you today. I thank you for this beautiful Mother's Day. I thank you for those who are able to be here with us in service. Thank you for those who are tuned in over Facebook Live this morning. And now, Lord, as we have worshiped through song and through our meeting here today, this is the time we worship in this word. So I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you have given unto us in this word, you have revealed it unto us by way of this word. I just pray that you bring it alive in our spirits here today, that we might hear that which you want us to hear as a church and as individuals, so that we will be better disciples and that we might be better evangelists. And we'll give you all the thanks and the praise and the glory for it. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we say and ask all these things. And the saints would say, we love you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Look around and wave and smile. We have guests in the service. Good to see Wayne and Linda, your grandson, here today. Thank you guys for being here. You can be seated. I was just thinking on the way over here, I had saw yesterday about a Facebook page. They had a little picture of a guy on there, and I thought it was cute, and he had this look on his face. And the post said, this is the look you have on your face when the preacher says that I'm closing, and then he does another 30 minutes. And I thought that was cute. And I thought on the way over here about when we were serving communion, and one little boy told the other little boy that was sitting beside of him, he said, we're going to be here a while because they're starting to serve lunch. And so I thought we might not be here that long, but we're going to see what the Lord has to say to us, and I appreciate it taking the time to come. Well, let's talk about Jesus being the author and the finisher of our faith. I don't know about you, but when you read those words and the word author hits you, the first thing you think about is somebody that wrote something. That's what you think about when you think about the word author. And we can apply that because we know that God inspired the people who wrote this book. We know he did that. So if you take that in one context and say Jesus is the author of our faith, then we can just simply say because he has written it in this word, he has given it to us in this word. But the interesting thing about the scriptures and the way that they're translated, and I don't always try to go back and pull up the Greek or you know, the ancient languages, because I don't want you to get the idea that the English Bibles that we have are no benefit. So I don't want to pull all the other languages into that to try to make you think that we're not getting exactly what it is God wants us to know. We are. But in this case, the word author is not talking about somebody who actually wrote something. But the word author in this context simply means the originator, the one who created it, the one who came up with it. That's what the word means. And then when you look at the last word, when we talk about being the finisher of our faith, well, the King James uses the word perfecter, which is the same thing. It means completeness. Then we know just from that one sentence, just from that one line, that Jesus started this thing and he's going to complete this thing. That's pretty simple. And that's a sermon within itself when you look at that. But let's talk a little bit about what I think the writer was trying to get us to understand. First of all, we don't know who the author of this book was. And it doesn't matter. We don't know who actually wrote Hebrews. I used to think it was Paul, but I find evidence in the book itself that kind of leans away from Paul, because the writer of the book tells us in the book that it was from eyewitness accounts that a lot of the information in this book came from. So Paul had an eyewitness account. So he would have had to write from an eyewitness perspective or from hearing from somebody else. But it's neither here nor there. What matters is God had it written to a specific group of people. And it wasn't just for that particular time. A lot of times, some of the scriptures that we read and some of the things that are written apply to people in a particular time or that we're in a particular situation. And that's why it's hard for us to take that and try to apply it to where we are. But that's not the case with this book. This book speaks to the whole church. And the reason is, when God had this written to the Hebrews, which is the Jews who were in the dispersion and who had been kicked out of Rome and sent all over the world, is we don't know exactly who the writer was or exactly who the group was that he was writing to in particular. So that takes all of us into account. But we do know he was talking mainly to the Jewish people, to the Hebrew people. And the reason he was is because of what we find out in the other letters that Paul had written, that a lot of times They were teaching that the law was still in effect, even though Jesus had come, even though he had died on the cross, even though he had been resurrected for our justification. A lot of the teachers in that day were still preaching and teaching that they had to follow the law in order that they might have favor with God. And that wasn't true. That wasn't true. Now, the law hasn't been done away with. Absolutely not. Because Jesus said, I come to fulfill it. I didn't come to do away with it. But the grace, the dispensation of grace that we have today, because of what Christ did for us on that cross, is how you and I are going to make it into heaven. We're going to make it into heaven not by keeping the Ten Commandments. We can't keep them perfectly even if we try. We're going to get there because Jesus kept them. Because he's the perfecter of our faith. And he's the one that completed it for us. And the sooner we learn that, the better we will be when it comes to judging ourselves in regards to sin and in regards to faith. And that's what the writer was trying to get this group to understand. They were going through severe persecution in that day. They had been dispersed. They were being oppressed. They still weren't being accepted into the society simply because of their association with Jesus Christ. Listen, we're there today. Those who are associated with Christ are not politically acceptable. I mean, let's be honest about it. It is not politically acceptable to believe in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is looked at as being another religion. Our belief is tolerated by those who don't believe what we believe. It can be tolerated, but still it is not acceptable even in our society that our belief in Christ as being the only way that we can be saved, and that's what the Bible teaches.
Amen.
And the fact that you and I believe that automatically put us at odds with other religions and people that think otherwise. So we can relate just a little bit into the society that this letter was written into. Now, what was happening is this persecution that was coming upon them was causing a lot of them to walk away from the faith. They were walking away from the faith because they thought, well, if Christ has come to redeem us and Christ has come to save us, then where is he? Where is he? Why hasn't he come back? Why hasn't he come and rescued us from this oppression? Why is he allowing his people to suffer? Why is his people still being persecuted? If he is the Redeemer, and he is the Savior, and he is the Messiah, why is it that his followers and his people are suffering? So the devil was able to move in on that as a minister of light, the Bible tells us, and convince a lot of people that there's nothing to this, that it's not real. If this thing was real, then Christians wouldn't suffer. If this thing was real, then Christians wouldn't have the issues that they had. Let me tell you something about Christians. For those of you who may not know a whole lot about us, we're human. We're human. We live in human bodies.
Yes.
We experience the same emotional and physical effects that every other living, breathing human does. We're all human. What separates us is we believe in this human Jesus who came as a human, suffered as a human, died as a human, was resurrected into a glorified body by the Almighty God, and has promised me that if I will put my faith in him and my trust in him and my belief in him, that the same Father that raised him from the dead will raise my body from the dead. And I believe that. And I trust in that. And that's why I believe what I do about who Christ is. So those who were walking away from the faith, God sent this letter that he might encourage them and help them to understand that Christ has not left us as orphans. Therefore, as chapter 12 starts out, the word therefore means that which you have been told before. When you look at chapter 11 in Hebrews, it's called the Hall of Faith. And chapter 11 in Hebrews speaks about all those who had faith in God and how their lives reflected that faith. Yet, those that it is written about never knew about Jesus. They never knew about Christ. But you know what they did know? They knew that God was a man of his word. They knew that God was a God of his word. What he had promised him, he was able to fulfill. What he had told them was going to happen, a lot of it had happened, and a lot of it is still yet going to happen. And they put their belief in this God who had told them that this is what he was going to do and how he was going to do it. And because they believed that, it was counted unto them as righteousness. Even though Christ had not come at that point, they were looking to Christ, even though they didn't understand exactly how God was going to pull this off. They didn't know exactly how this promise was going to come to pass, but they knew it would, Charlie, because they knew God, and they believed God, and they trusted him. So that's how it led up to chapter 12. Verse 11 in this chapter says, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of that which is not seen. To have evidence, if you have evidence, there is proof. There is proof. That's what evidence is. You know, the fact that I'm a little short of breath this morning is evidence that I had something going on in here. That is evident. You can't see that, but there is evidence that there was something going on there. It is the same with faith. Faith is made up of, the substance is what it's made of. It is made of things which are hoped for. What things are we hoping for? We're hoping for Christ to come back. We're hoping that Christ is going to rescue us. We're hoping that he's going to come and get us and take us to heaven.
Amen.
Well, we hope that. What are we doing about it? If that's what our hope is, what does that hope cause us to do? The evidence of that hope is we have put our belief in Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
If our hope is to be saved, then our trust has to be in the one that will save us. And the very fact that we put our belief in him and our faith in him, that is the evidence that we believe we're going to have that what we hope for. Does that make sense? That's what he was trying to get them to understand. He was telling them, listen, your hope and your faith is not in vain. Even though you don't see this happening right now, and even though it doesn't seem like it may ever happen, because Peter said there has always been scoffers. Peter said there's always been those who have said, well, he's promised to come. I've heard it all my life. Listen, he's closer now than he was when I started this morning.
Amen.
He's closer to coming now than he was 15 minutes ago. And he is going to come. He said he would, and he will. You can take that to heaven.
Amen.
It's going to happen. That's the faith that we hold on to simply because of what Christ has told us that he's going to do. He originated that. Verse 13 in the chapter says, these, those in chapter 11, they all died in faith, not having received the promises. But, I like that but having seen them afar off, down the road, okay, they were assured of them. They embraced them, and they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Let me put that in the Ivanhoe language. We're just passing through.
Yes, sir.
We're just passing through. This is not our home. This is where we reside. This is where we're stationed for the moment, but our home is eternal.
Yeah.
Our home is in heaven with Christ.
Amen.
We are citizens of that country, which is not made with hands. We're citizens of that eternity that God has put together for us. He is going to prepare that place for us and will come again and receive us, that where he is, there we may be also. And that's where we're headed. And that's where we will go.
Yeah.
We are strangers and pilgrims on this earth. That's why we're not politically accepted. That's where we don't fit in with the world's teaching, because we know that we're not part of this world.
Right.
I had a friend tell me one time at work, Charlie knows you, we had a lot of discussions at work about the Bible. And this guy said, I wish all you Christians would just get on a big jumbo jet and fly out of here and leave the rest of us alone. And I said, it's going to happen, but it won't be on a jumbo jet. We're going to go.
Yeah.
Christ is going to come.
Yeah.
And we'll be out of here. But it's not going to be the way you think. But that's what the writer of Hebrews was wanting those people in that day to understand. Listen, your faith is not in vain. Your hope is not in vain. What God has started, he is fulfilling, and he is going to finish.
Amen.
He is the author, and he is the finisher. He is the originator, and he is the consummator. He is the Alpha, and he is the Omega. And you can count on that.
Amen.
And that's the message he is trying to get us to understand. In verse 39 of chapter 11, he said, all these, then he can go back and read chapter 11, read about all of them. He said, all these, having obtained a good testimony, someone said, in order to have a testimony, you got to go through a test. Maybe true. But in order to have a good testimony, they obtained it through faith. And again, the writer emphasizes, they did not receive the promise. They died not receiving the promise of deliverance that God had promised them. Think of all of those whose mothers have gone on. Think of all our moms who prayed for us. Think of all those grandmothers and all those who prayed for us. And they have since long gone. And they were there with Christ. And they are where they especially wanted us to be. And all those, they died not receiving the promise that was given to them, and the same promise that is given to us. If he does not come in my lifetime, I will wait by way of the grave. But listen, that's not going to change the fact that he's not going to come, Charles. He's going to come. Whether I'm here or whether I'm in the ground as a body, he is going to come just as he said he would. And the writer said they didn't receive the promise. Here's why. God, having provided something better for us.
Yes, man.
Who is us talking about? Us. For us. It didn't say God provided something better for some folk, or he provided something better for a particular group, or he provided something better for them, that he has provided something better for us.
Amen.
Us. He's provided something better for us, so that they should not be made complete, or they should not be completed or perfected apart from us.
Amen.
I like this. Put a little thought into that, exactly what he's saying. Here's what he's saying. Yes, the Jews were the people of God. Yes, they were. He chose them. He called them out. He appointed them. They had the mission of living his word, not just knowing it. It was their mission to show the rest of the humans on earth the God that they serve, and how good he was, and how powerful he was, and how justified he is, and the fact that if they would obey him, that the rest of the world can look at those people and say, man, I wish I had their God. That was the point. He pulled them out and he made them who they were. But listen, just as Christians are human, they're human. And they were human. And they went the human route, as all humans do. Isaiah said all of us are like sheep that are going astray. You put a bunch of sheep in a field, they can have all the grass they want to eat right there, but they'll do their best to go find something else. Yeah. Huh? They'll do that. They'll stray, thinking that there's grass somewhere else better than what they're standing in. That's what humans do. Humans go the other way. But I'm glad God knew that we would. He knew that. He understood that. That was part of the plan in the beginning. And what he has provided for us is the fact that you and I will reap the same rewards that the people of God would have reaped if they would have obeyed him as he intended for them to. See, the Jews had an idea in their head that they're the only ones that God that had favor with God. If you weren't a Jew, listen, you were just fuel for the fire. That's how they saw it. That's how they taught it. That's how they believed it. That's why Christ came. Christ came to say, I don't care if you're a Jew. I don't care if you're an Ethiopian. I don't care if you're an African. I don't care if you're from Slab Town. I don't care if you're from New York. It doesn't make any difference. What makes a difference is the blood of the Savior that's applied to your heart. Amen. That's what saves us. Not our ethnicity, but our Savior is who saves us. It doesn't matter of what ethnic descent you might be. And the Jews were having trouble wrapping their minds around that. And the writer to the Hebrews said, listen, God has something perfected for us, not just for them, not just for those who have gone on, but for those of us who are still here. And those of us who are still coming into the world, God still has that plan in place. He has provided something better for us. What he has provided for us? The cross. He provided the sacrifice of his own son for us. He didn't sacrifice Christ just for the Jews. He sacrificed Christ for all of us. Christ died for all. Amen. Not for a particular group of people, but for all people. That's why he came. That's what he did. That's what he does. And that's what he's continuing to do. That's why the writer of Hebrews also says in another place, he is able to save to the uttermost those who will come to God through him. Listen, that's the only way to God, guys. That's the only way. Oprah Winfrey's wrong. There are not many paths to God. There's only one, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
He is the door. He is the truth. He is the life. He is the way. He is the only way. No, that's not possible, but that's the truth. And once we realize that, then we know that he not only originated this plan, but he's going to fulfill this plan. Salvation was promised in the Garden of Eden. You don't have to read far into Genesis to find out that after the fall, that God stepped in and did what he had planned to do even before he had made Adam and Eve. When they succumbed to the devil and they went their human way, as all humans do, all like sheep go astray, when they went their way, God could have simply said, think about it, God could have simply said, I'm done with this bunch. They're never going to obey me. These crooked little creatures, they're nothing but his. He can wipe them all out. You and I may have never come into existence. We may have never had no conscience being. Think about that. That's deep thought. There may have never been a us, Charles. We don't know but that wasn't the plan. But there is an us. Because he knew that's what the plan was going to be. And he took those disobedient creatures, those disobedient children, and what did he do? Well, they covered themselves with fig leaves because somebody told them they was naked. Wasn't that a shock? They didn't know what neck it was until they disobeyed the Father.
Right.
They thought they wanted to know good from evil, but when they finally figured out what was evil, they wished they hadn't ever figured it out. But they did, and once they did, God didn't say, I'm done with you. God took innocent blood. Read it. He took the skins of animals. Now, the animals hadn't done that. But he took their skins to cover the disobedient creatures. He did that. Innocent blood was shed that guilty blood might be covered. That was in the beginning, Charlie. Thousands of years ago, he did that. And he made this statement to Eve. He said, your seed, S-E-E-D, he was referring to Christ even in that scripture. And they wouldn't know that till Christ had come. And he said, there will be enmity between your seed and the seed of the serpent. Folks, we're living it today.
Yep.
We're living it today. That's why people drive through neighborhoods and shoot innocent toddlers. Their mothers are carrying them down the street and somebody drives by in a car and kills both of them. That's why they go into schools and shoot people. That's why they go into malls and shoot people. The enemy, Satan's seed, is enmity against everybody else. Everybody else. Well, it's just against Christians. No, it's against every living, breathing human. Why? Because every living, breathing human is created in the image of Almighty God, and Satan hates God, and he hates you because you remind him of God.
Yes.
And if he can get somebody to kill you, it might make him feel better. That may be what the goal is, but it doesn't take away the fact that God has a plan.
Right.
And he said there will be enmity, but here's what he promised. He said Satan will snap his heel. Yeah, Satan's doing that today. Satan's killing left and right today. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and it's happening. But, I like the rest of that sentence, that he will crush his heel.
Yes.
That cross. That put the end of Satan's reign.
Yep.
That put the end of Satan's reign. That's why Jesus made a statement to his disciples. Don't fear those who can kill the body. Don't fear those who can kill the body, but they cannot kill the soul by sending it to hell. See, you and I are a living spirit. You and I are going to live forever. Once Christ brought us into existence, we're never going to go out of existence. We're always going to exist somewhere for eternity. Somewhere. And God made a way that we can be with him for eternity. And that's why Christ came. And that's why he died on the cross. And that's why his blood was shed. And that's why God resurrected him. And that's why, as the writer says right here in the last part of verse 2, he has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Listen, the famous thing that Christ comes, then God put all this stuff into existence. He set the world on the end of his finger like a basketball. He gave it a spin. When he quits turning, it's over.
Wrong.
That's a fatalistic view. That's a wrong view. God is a personal God. He brought us into existence because he wanted us. He wanted you as an individual to spend eternity with him. If he hadn't, he would have never made you. You weren't an accident. You were brought into existence so that God may have you be with him forever. And he not only wanted that, he made it happen by coming in the flesh, dying on the cross, and being resurrected so that all who will, Charles, all who want to,
amen,
can call upon him and be saved,
yes,
from eternal damnation. That's his plan. He came up with that plan. He's the author of it. He's the originator of it. He's the finisher of it. He will complete it. He will consummate it. He is the fulfiller of it, sitting at the right hand of God. Listen, God's not done with us. He's not done with this world. He's not done with us. His plan is on track. It's as real today as it was the day. has changed that. This pandemic hasn't messed up God's life. It may have messed up ours. It's messed up the way we do business. But listen, it ain't done nothing to God. It ain't affected him one way or the other. It's still on track exactly the way he put it on track.
Yes.
And it's going to end that way. And he's sitting with the Father. He's going to come again to complete that plan. The plan will be completed. It's in the process of being fulfilled. Yes, he will come for his church. And as we're studying in Revelation, at the end of that tribulation, he will come back to earth and establish the millennial kingdom for the 1,000 years, and that will lead us directly into eternity. It's still out there. It's still going to happen. Hang on, church. Hang on.
Yes.
He started it. He'll finish it.
Amen.
That's who he is. That's what he does. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Here's your whole message. God came up with the plan of salvation. God's going to complete the plan of salvation. And if we put our faith in anything else other than Christ, we are wasting our faith.
Amen.
We are wasting our faith. There are people I've had said one time in a Sunday school class I got to hear him teach. He said one time, he reached in his pocket, pulled out his car keys. Charlie, he said, we got more faith in these than we do God sometimes.
That's right.
That's what Dan said. And he went on to explain it. He said, because when I leave here today, he said, I'm going to go out there in the parking lot. I'm going to stick this key in that switch, and I'm going to turn it over, and I'm going to be waiting to hear that engine. I'm expecting that engine to start, and my mind is already telling me where I'm going to go once I get on the run.
Yep.
All that for that little key. He said, that's how much faith I got in that key. Now, he said, if I put that key in that switch, and I turn it over, and it don't start, he said, then things change. Then things change. But he said, I'm not going to go out here, and I'm not going to raise my hood, and I'm not going to see if my battery cables are connected, and I'm not going to go call a mechanic and say, check this car out before I turn that key, because I want to make sure it starts. He said, none of that's going to happen unless it don't start. But he said, when I go out this door, none of that's on my mind. I know that this key is going to start that car. Listen, I know that this word is going to take me to heaven.
Yes.
I don't have to doubt it. I don't have to test it. I don't have to just wait and see. I know that it's going to do what it says it will do.
Amen.
Because Jesus is the author. He originated it. He came up with the plan. He is fulfilling the plan. He is the perfecter of that plan. He is the finisher of that plan. So the faith that I have was given to me as a gift by him. Each one has been given a measure of faith. Everybody who wants to believe can believe. Now I know, you have all these discussions. You have all these, there are people out there that spend their time and doing nothing else. As Paul said about the Greeks, they want to learn something new or hear something new or try to get something explained. I told you about the guy that asked me about the little red Aborigines over in Australia out back who's never heard of Jesus. What's going to happen to them? I told you how the answer comes from that. Well, it's the same thing where people say, well, what about these folk who aren't in their right mind? What about these people who can't think correctly? What about those who are mentally challenged? Listen, you let God worry about them. Okay? He knows them. They're his. He knows who he has in this world. Jesus said, I know my sheep, and they hear my voice. We don't have to worry about them. We don't have to worry about that hottentot Aborigine over there in that jungle in Australia who's never heard the name of Jesus, and he dies. We don't have to worry about him. God take care of him. You know who I got to worry about? Because you know why? I've heard about Jesus, and I know who Jesus is, and I know what I have to do in regards to Jesus. God will take care of the hottentot. He'll take care of me, too. I'm the one that has to make the decision. He's the author and the finisher of my faith. My faith is given to me as a gift. I didn't have to work it up. I didn't have to invent it. I didn't have to imagine it. let's get ready for the next one. That's the first one. Father, we thank you today. I thank you for these who have come. I thank you for their attention. But more importantly, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that you are the author and you are the finisher of our faith. We couldn't make this thing happen even if we tried. As your servant, the late Dr. Billy Graham said, no matter how good we try to be, we'll never be good enough. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you that we don't have to try to be good enough. That you were good enough for us. That you brought us into existence for the very purpose of spending eternity with us. And you made that happen. Not only did you create us, you're not just the author of our life. You're the author of our faith. You gave us that faith as a gift by way of the cross. And all you have told us to do is to believe it. That's all we have to do. That's all we have to do. You told the disciples one time, that the Pharisees asked, what do we do to do the works of God? You said, believe in him whom he sent. That's the works of God. That's what we're to do. And our faith, Lord, our faith is in you. It can't be in ourselves. It can't be in the moral systems. Our faith has got to be rooted and grounded only in Christ. And if we will do that, you will not let us down. None of us who put our faith in you will be ashamed. None of us who trust in you for our salvation will be let down. It just doesn't happen that way. You originated it, you're fulfilling it, and you'll consummate it. One of these days, we talk about heaven a lot. We talk about it more at funerals than we do anywhere else. But Lord, one of these days, we are all of us who are your children, we're going to be there with you. It's going to happen. We can trust that because your word is true. So now go with us. Go with us as we leave this building today and enjoy this Mother's Day that you have given us. And Father, I just pray that each moment we'll just realize just how blessed we are. As John said at the very beginning, what a blessed people we are to have you as our God. And we'll give you the thanks and praise and glory for it all in your wonderful name, Jesus. We say it by faith. And the saints would say, love you, Lord. Amen and amen. Thank you for being here today. God bless your fellowship. On the way out, wave and smile. Listen, Bible study starts back Wednesday night. Lord willing, we'll be back here on Wednesday. God bless you. You all have a great day in the Lord.